Hi, is Jesse there?
Yes.
Hi, I have a sleepy Matthew Bellamy in the conference room with you.
I'm sorry, I feel bad for waking him up.
I woke him up. You're free. Matthew, are you
Hello.
on? This is
Hello.
You're on with Jesse.
Hey, how's it going?
Hi, Matt. I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
Oh, no worries. No, it's fine. I'm up. I'm definitely up now.
You know, I actually had a phone call last week. We just announced our Edge Fest, and Jared Leto had to call from Finland, and he was also asleep, and they woke him up to do the interview, and it drove the ladies crazy. So go ahead and talk in your sleepy voice, because I'm sure your female fans will lose their minds.
Okay.
How are you? Where are you?
That's a good question. Let me think about that.
The
I think
plight of bands. I don't know where the hell I'm at.
I'm in Nashville, but I was just but yesterday I was in the land between the lakes. That's a place that we were in some place that was we went out on these ATVs, these kind of quad bikes, somewhere in the middle of Tennessee, and it was just called the land between the lakes. That's where
Fun.
we were.
How was that?
Oh,
Wow.
it was really cool. Yeah, we ripped across the beach and in the woods and all this kind of stuff. And yeah, we had a good day.
Well, I'm actually glad that you brought up the beach because when I was preparing for this interview, I found a really beautiful interview with you. I think it was with your hometown news station because I guess you guys did like this huge show last year in your hometown of is it Teignmouth in
Oh,
Devon?
Timothy, yeah.
Well, it was amazing because the news reporter was so excited, and she said that the Muse show there was the biggest event since 1967 when the Beatles came, and the Beatles didn't even play. They just slept there? Well, that's kind of crazy. I mean, it's funny. The Beatles slept here, but now they can change those signs to Muse grew up here.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah, that was great. It was like a homecoming gig for us, you know. It was like the first time we'd played in that town since probably since we were kids or something, you know, like since about 15, 16, and it was great playing to all these the crowd was pretty much all of our old school friends and ex-girlfriends. So
Well, I was
it was
going to
pretty
ask,
weird.
did you bumped into the first girl you ever kissed?
Yeah, and yeah, bumped into all those. Yeah, the first girl I tried to kiss and failed, and the first girl that I actually did kiss, my first girlfriend.
I bet she's kicking herself now.
She's pregnant. She's got two kids now,
Oh my God. And
so
here
she's
you are
perfect.
taking over the world. I win.
Right.
What now, the field that you played on was actually the field that you used to play football on and you met Dom there?
That's right. Yeah. It was. We used to. It was a place where. So kids used to go and play football and like hang around and stuff. And I used to hang around with the sort of more sporty type kids when I was younger. But Dom was like, look, he was like hanging around with all these kids that looked like Kurt Cobain with long hair, and we always used to sort of laugh at them. But at one point, I broke the ice and went over and had a chat to Dom, and he asked me to be in his band. And so I started to learn the guitar, and I joined his band. But you know, I looked like a kind of sport guy, you know, like hanging around with all these kind of grunge kids. So I didn't really fit in, but. Within about 3 or 4 years, and I had long hair as well, so I kind of gradually adapted.
Was this when you guys were originally called the Rocket Baby Dolls?
That's right, yeah, Rocket Baby Dolls. That was the first band we started here.
Now, was the CD by the Rocket Baby Dolls or the tape, whatever you had, was that the one that the mayor threw away? I heard something about the mayor of the town said you were that kind of, he didn't like it and he threw it in the rubbish bin.
That was actually Muse, believe it or not. That was our first Muse
No.
record. It was the first Muse EP that we made. It had like four or five songs on, and the mayor. And the mayor had a picture of himself on the front of a newspaper throwing it in the bin. And
No! Wow.
that was the same mayor that was like trying to do photos with us when we came to do the gig and wanted to come on stage and introduce us and everything. And we
Did you
basically said
let him?
no. No, we said no, I think that would be a little bit inappropriate due to the fact that you threw our CD in the bin
Did you
10 years
take the
ago.
picture and say, this was you 10 years ago? You're a
Exactly, yeah, he
fool.
was just in total denial, you know. But it
What?
was.
Did you end up running? I heard about your teacher that was very supportive, Jill Bird. Was she at that show?
Oh, she is there. Yeah, it was great to see her. Yeah, she was. In fact, she was like a really kind of far out music teacher because the music department was way off in the, and all the kids used to go there and sort of do things that you could never do in the school, which I can't mention. But basically, it was a place where kids would sort of more would party, and she was kind of a very, very liberal teacher who would just let kids do anything they wanted, basically. So we'd all end up going to the music department, and she would let us have band practices there after hours and all this kind of stuff. So she was very cool.
Her heart must have exploded watching you come back and be hometown heroes. How amazing was that for her?
Oh yeah, she loved it. Yeah, she was all over it. Yeah, she was very, very emotional.
In all the interviews that I've read with you, you talk quite a bit about how music is where you get to explore everything that you weren't necessarily taught in school. I mean, schools kind of have this cookie-cutter way of teaching kids by rote, and I've read that since you've gotten out of school, you're kind of a research hound, and, you know, you do find a lot of conspiracy theories, but you take stuff with a grain of salt, but you kind of apply that to especially your lyrical content in an effort to kind of galvanize people globally to wake up.
Definitely, yeah. I think, yeah, there's certain things that you don't really learn in school, I suppose, you know, how strong the media is and how influential it can be over people's opinions and how the advertising industry can lead people towards certain ways of thinking and ways of life, which maybe not are always what we'd naturally choose. And so I think I suppose, did a lot of research into, you know, how there's a guy called Edward Bernays, the nephew of Sigmund Freud, who basically discovered all this stuff about how to manipulate people using the mass media and stuff, and it's been used the last sort of few decades. And so I think it's good for people to learn about that stuff because you don't really get taught that stuff in school. So I sort of learned about it myself, really, and sort of to an extent you start to see through a lot of the kind of spin that is going on out there, especially from all the political parties and the advertising industry and stuff. And I think it's good for people to kind of make their own mind up, really, and get their own opinion and not just do what they're told from the television, you know?
No, that's interesting. I've actually done some research lately. I found some books about consumer psychology, and it's actually kind of horrifying and kind of a testament to the idea that occasionally ignorance can be bliss.
it can be kind of scary, but I think that, you know, I'm optimistic. I think that humans are generally good people. I think, you know, I think people are fundamentally good, and I think that the kind of advertising industry in the last 30, 40 years, and also the sort of capitalist kind of free market system, which has served very well to sort of get the society to where it is, but I think it's also damaged people's perceptions of each other a little bit, and led to certain things that get done in our name, like wars and things, which people probably fundamentally wouldn't agree to. But I think that the more people research about it, the more they're able to actually just kind of make their own opinion, really. And I think people, when people get to that point, they will usually find out that decisions are much better made and much more caring for their fellow people and all that kind of stuff. You know, I think a lot of the time we're isolated from each other deliberately, and to be kind of as you said, like kind of consumers and basically products. You know, but we're much more than that, obviously. And I think people are waking up to that, yeah.
I was intrigued by some of the books that I had read had kind of inspired some of the lyrical content on the resistance, and the one that really captured my attention was the one by John Perkins, The Diary of an Economic Hitman.
Oh, yeah, that's a great book, yeah.
How did you find that? Because I had bumped into John Perkins' work before because I knew of his work dealing with shamans and shape-shifting. So when I heard about Diary of an Economic Hitman, it was really a struggle to try and